إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Our praise and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek His assistance, His guidance, and His forgiveness. And we take refuge with Him from the evil within our souls and from the consequence of our misdeeds. Whoever Allah gives guidance to, none can mislead, and whoever He misleads, none can guide. I testify that there's nothing and no one worthy of worship besides Allah alone. He has no partners, and I testify that Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, peace and blessings be upon him, is his servant and messenger. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant him peace and to send him our salutations on this blessed day. This as we ask him to grant peace to his family members, his companions, and all of those who follow goodness and exhibit goodwill unto me and the reckoning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, when he appeared in Mecca, he appeared to a people with a specific identity. The religion meant a lot to them. They were idolaters, as we know. But more than their idolatry, their tribalism is what ultimately defined who they were. That they were concerned very much about who their fathers were, and their fathers' fathers, and the achievements of their fathers. And when the Prophet ﷺ came, he revolutionized Meccan society, he revolutionized the world, as we know. And most importantly, what he did, and he revolutionized it with respect to what he made to be the most important aspect of any person's identity, which was their religion, or I would say their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That instead of an emphasis on who your father was, Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, he turned the Muslims turned their attention to the aspect of every person, human being's being, which is considered to be the most valuable, the most important thing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was their iman. So they went from identifying themselves with their tribes, not that they completely gave it up, but what became more important was their belief in Allah and the belief in the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And in the time that we live during this era, identity once again is something which has become very crucial. If anything, there's a lot of talk of what is called identity politics going on. And for America, which is a place whose identity, not only as a country, a democracy, a place where people were expected to live free, but a country that defined itself on the basis of racial discrimination, of racial differentiation. But we have today even more complicated, much more complicated than even racial identity politics. But gender identity politics exists as well. To the extent that there are those who believe that you can just simply change your sex by thinking it, that you, if you wake up this morning and you are biologically a man and you think that you're a woman, then that's what you are today, or vice versa. But at any rate, the whole point being that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came into the world, he came into Mecca and in Arabia and revolutionized their sense of identity. And one of the things that Islam is known for is for what is sometimes called its radical monotheism, Tawheed. Islam is not only opposed to the worship of physical idols, but Islam is concerned with anything that will, that the human being will attach within her heart to, which is other than the one who deserves the attachment of their hearts, the creator of all. So this is why the Quran talks about how an individual can take their hawa as their ilah, their lust or their whim as their god. Because the Islamic monotheism is radical. It is something revolutionary. It's something that when it enters into any given society, if it is, if it comes in this pure fashion, it revolutionizes society. It changes people. It changes society. It makes us not only look to ourselves and become selfish, because Islam is not a selfish religion. Rather, Islam is concerned about everybody. That it's about honoring God, but also aren't honoring the neighbor. That in the Quran, when Allah speaks about this ummah and what makes it the best of ummah, the best of communities, he mentions that ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar, that you enjoin what is good, you forbid what is wrong, and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that's what makes you the best ummah. Because you begin with enjoining good and forbidding wrong. But what is this good and that which we call ma'ruf and munkar? What is that? Who defines what that is? The Muslim believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines the ma'ruf, the good. And he defines the munkar, that which is bad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determines that. Even if we ourselves may be able to perceive the general harm that something may bring to us, or the general good or benefit that something may come to us if we indulge in it. Just because we perceive of that doesn't make the actual thing good or evil. Because sometimes there are some things that are good in the beginning, but in long term they're bad. Or they're bad in the beginning, but in the long term they're good. There's hardship that comes from not eating and drinking during the daytime. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't consider that to be an evil. If anything, considered it to be a good. We fast the month of Ramadan, right, for instance. Right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us some criteria. On the Fath of Mecca, the day of the conquest of Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stood up and gave a speech. And this is what he said. Ayyuha an-nas, inna Allah qad adhhab 'ankum 'ubdiyyat al-jahiliyyati wa ta'adduha bi aba'iha. O people, O men, Allah has rid you of the vainglory of the pre-Islamic days and your magnification or their magnification of their fathers. فَالنَّاسُ رَجُلَانِ. Men are of two types. People are of two types. رَجُلٌ بَرٌ تَقِيٌّ كَرِيمٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ. One type of person is one who is righteous, upright, and has value in the sight of God. وَفَاجِرٌ شَقِيٌّ حَيٌّ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And the other is a wicked person who is wretched, wretched person who is insignificant in God's sight. وَكُلُّكُمْ مِنْ آدَمْ وَخَلَقَ اللَّهُ آدَمْ مِنَ التُرَابِ أو مِنْ تُرَابِ. All of you, or each of you, is from Adam, and Allah created Adam from dirt. Now I begin this way, of course, because I'm leading up to something. And the most important question I think that I wanted to lead up to is the question of the value of being a Muslim. What value
does being a Muslim have in our times when we think about the ideas of identity? What sort of identity do you have? What is the most important aspect of your identity? What is the value of being a Muslim? Is a Muslim just simply anything that a person who calls him or herself a Muslim says it is? And we say, no, of course it is not. Islam is not a culture. Islam is not a race. Islam is a religion. Right? And you can't just decide what Islam is on any given day. Islam is what it is. I wanted to tell a story, but after reciting a verse from Surah Al-A'raf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَصَلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْصَرَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَسْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. He said, recite to them the story or the news of the one we gave our signs to. And then he was stripped of it. And then Satan was given power over him. And later he was among the misled, those who were misled. وَلَوْ شِئْنَا وَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا. If we had willed, we would have lifted him up with them, meaning these signs. And I'll come back to talk about what this is a reference to. وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. However, he clung to the earth and he followed his desire and his will. فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلَ الْكَلْبِ إِنْ تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثُ أَوْ تَتْرُكُ يَلْهَثُ. So his similitude is as the dog. If you place something on his back to carry, it'll just put its tongue out and pant. And if you leave it, or you don't put anything on his back, it'll put its tongue out and pant. ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ قَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. Said that is the similitude of those who belie the signs of God, those who don't believe them to be true. فَقْصُصُ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So then Allah says, so tell the story so that they may reflect, so that they may think about it. The Mufassirin mention a couple of different things about this verse in terms of who it is a reference to. Who is this person that Allah gave his signs and he was stripped of them? Who is this person? The majority of them say that this particular person was a man from Bani Israel, from the children of Israel, by the name of Bal'am ibn Ba'ura. Bal'am ibn Ba'ura. According to one story, Bal'am ibn Ba'ura was a follower of Musa alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him knowledge of the greatest name. Now the greatest name was a name specific and hidden from most people, that for those who discover what that name is of Allah's, then if they call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that name, Allah will give them whatever they want at any time that they want. You will be mujab al-da'wah, that you will be an individual whose prayers are always answered immediately. And Bal'am ibn Ba'ura was a wali in that sense, that he was saintly. In that sense, it said he was from the family of Lut alayhi salam. And so Musa alayhi salam, according to this first story, he sends Bal'am to the king of Madian, calling him, inviting him to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the king seduced Bal'am by offering him lands. And Bal'am accepted, and he left the deen of Musa into the deen of the king, according to this story. That's one version of the account of Bal'am. The other or more popular account of Bal'am is that the Bal'am was from the people of Ariha, of Jericho. And we know the story in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Musa alayhi salam had brought the children of Israel out of bondage, and Allah asked them to go into a town and to fight a people, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give them inheritance of that land. And they refused and said, no, there are fi qawmun jabbarin, and the fiha qawmun jabbarin, that there are some, these massive, these giant, these people there. Right? And so because of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he punished them to wander in the desert for 40 years. But Bal'am was amongst these people. But he was a believer, in spite of that, from a people of the book. And so Musa alayhi salam, according to one version and another version, Yusha ibn Nun, who actually the prophet who came after Musa alayhi salam, had come to liberate or to gain to acquire what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had promised the chosen of Israel, naturally the people of Ariha, Jericho, seeing these massive numbers of people coming, they're going to get ready to fight. Because this is the type of world that they existed back then. That if you didn't know these people, they didn't have treaties, and people would just, you know, get gotten. That was the way that it worked. But at any rate, they're on their way. The people see and hear that Musa alayhi salam is coming. And so they go and appeal to Bal'am, knowing that he is an individual. When he asks Allah, anytime he asks Allah for something, that Allah gives it to him. And they asked Bal'am, pray against Moses. Pray against Musa alayhi salam, ask Allah to destroy him and destroy the army. Now Bal'am, of course, was uneasy about this. He said, no, how can I do this? This is God's messenger coming, and I can't pray against God's messenger. So he turns to Allah according to one aspect of the story. He makes a dua and expects a response. And he receives a response. And the response is that don't fight against Musa alayhi salam. The people, they are uneasy. He tells the people, no, I can't do anything here. So the people, they insist, and they offer him gift after gift after gift. And so his wife suggests to him to ask Allah again to see what he says. So he turns and asks Allah about what he should do. This time he doesn't receive a response. And once he tells those around him about it, they say, well, this has to be a sign that if Allah didn't tell you no, that must mean it's okay. Right? So Bal'am, he goes out to the battlefield and he starts to pray against Musa alayhi salam and his people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow for his tongue to speak the words or the prayers of the prayers that would be against Musa alayhi salam. But actually, every time he tried to make a prayer against Musa, the prayer was made against his own people. And when he tried to pray for his people, it would be in the favor of the people of Musa alayhi salam. And as a result of this, and because of his clinging to the earth and his heart being attached to wealth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he stripped his sign from him. Knowledge of the greatest name and his sense of, or sort of the status of sainthood. Now I mentioned all of this because I think one of the lessons we should learn from the story is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he will test all of us to see where our hearts are, as he is now with many of the believers. That he's testing us, and we continue to test us. And just because we see ourselves as Muslims, we may not actually be as committed to this book as we should be. There was a time, there have been times from ancient times, there have been people who would say that, okay, the Quran's enough. That's all we need. Imam Shafi'i talks about them in his Risala. He refutes them. So people say, all we need is the Quran. We don't need the Hadith. But I'm afraid that we're living in a time now where many Muslims have attitudes that, you know, we don't even need the Quran anymore. We don't even need the Quran. Right? Or anything in the Quran that's problematic, then we have to toss it aside. Find a way to make some claim about it, or at least we just cherry pick. Present books, I'm fine with these verses, and those other verses I'm not fine with. The Prophet predicted this. This is similar to what we find amongst the Christians and amongst the Jews, the attitude with their own books. You know, and the Prophet said, لَتَتَّبِعُونَ سُنَنَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ حَبْرَ الْقُدْوَةِ إِلَى قُدْوَةِ حَتَّى وَلَوْ دَخَلُوا جَهْرَ ضَبًّا لَدَخَلْتُمُوهُمْ. That you will indeed follow the ways of those who came before you, exactly identical to them, up to the point that if one of them were to go into a lizard's hole, then you would follow it, you would follow them into it. Kuna manhum ya Rasulullah al Yahud wa Nasara. He said, who are these people, Messenger of Allah? The Jews and the Christians? Qala faman. He said, who else am I talking about? But he talked about this, this sort of attitude that Muslims have with the Book of Allah. How much do we even read the Book of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to even know what's there? But we have what we have today. What I've noticed, I feel, has become very dangerous is that many Muslims seem to feel that I'm just simply a Muslim if I say I am. Or I can define Islam and Muslims any way that I want to. And as long as I call myself a Muslim, then I should be okay. So instead of me rejecting the Quran outright or openly, what I do is I try to redefine what a Muslim is, or I actually simply change the definition of a Muslim, thinking that by in doing so, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to hold me accountable for rejecting his book, for rejecting his book. That we live in a situation or a time when you have Muslims making certain things lawful, unlawful, and vice versa. You find many Muslims who are pro-LGBTQ, but they're anti-polygyny. And you may have an issue with polygyny, but it's really interesting how something that's clearly haram in the Quran, Muslims themselves are advocating for it. And they're against the opposite, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly allows under the right conditions. That we find people saying that, oh, there's no difference between man and woman. They say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly said, the male is unlike the female. And we're not even talking about issues of superiority, but there's a difference between the two. You can't be a woman just because you think you are. You have to actually be one, or vice versa. You can't just, you know, if Allah, that he brought you into this world and you have certain organs on your body, then you belong to that particular sex or gender. You can't choose whatever you want. But there are many Muslims who are pushing forward with these ideas. Well, even the idea that really there's no difference between Muslims and non-Muslims anyway. We're all human beings, which is true, of course. We all share our humanity. But you're not going to tell me that if you place an atheist beside a believer, and even if you say both of them, they say the atheist person is somewhat a moral person, and the believer is a moral person, that you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh, there's no difference between those two. Allah, he loves iman. He hates kufr. He loves iman. So don't tell me there's no difference between a believer and an unbeliever. أَفَمَنْ كَانَ مُؤْمِنًا كَمَنْ كَانَ فَاسِقًا لَا يَسْتَوُونَ. Is the believer like the transgressor? Right? They are not equal. That's what the Quran teaches us. أَفَنَجْعَلَ مُسْلِمِينَ كَمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Will you make the Muslims like the criminals? What's wrong with you? How do you judge? Questions asked in the Quran about that. And again, this is not to say that we should have an arrogant attitude and look down upon people, or that we call all our Muslims, maybe we just consider them criminals. And if people are criminals against God, they commit crimes against God by not believing in God, right? That is a crime, right? But there is a difference. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loves iman. Iman is part of our identity. We are Muslims, we are believers, right? And it should mean something to us. That there is a Muslim way to look at things. But we won't know that if we don't read the book. And then even if we read the book, it won't mean anything if we don't believe in the book. We don't believe that it's revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what really is the point? You can't trick God. You can't trick without God, but simply trying to redefine Muslim. Right? Redefine Muslim. You're not going to trick God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his definition of Muslim. He has his definition of mu'min. He has his definition of muhsin. You can't trick God by creating a new definition to make life easy for yourself somehow, because you have some type of attachment to this world. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to live in this world firm upon faith, and to leave this world firm upon faith.